All right. Well, y'all ready to have a little church this morning? Let's open up our Bibles to Galatians chapter 4, verses 8 through 20, as we continue on with the series of study that we have entitled Deeper, the Gospel of Galatians, where we have said in scholarship that the letter of Galatians is known here as the Magna Carta of Christian freedom. The letter of Galatians was written to remind Christ followers that once you put your trust and faith in Jesus, that you truly are free. You truly are redeemed. You truly are saved. And so you do not need to, as the Galatians did in their day, stumble in such a way that you start to remix the gospel to believe that you need Jesus plus someone, Jesus plus something. But the gospel rests on very capable footing. Hallelujah, the shed blood of Jesus Christ. And so we've been marching through our letter week after week after week to say essentially the same thing. Your salvation is this, Jesus only. When we left off last time, Paul the apostle and pastor had cried out to the Galatians so as to say, come out of slavery, for you have been adopted as sons and as daughters of the living God. He said, basically, know who you are and know whose you are in Christ. He continues the conversation today on pretty much the same subject, that this is the good news of Jesus, that you truly are free. Visit now a Roman prison 2,000 years ago, and a wearied and aged apostle, even though in chains, is rejoicing in the freedom that is in Christ. He has faithfully captured the episode for us, and he writes to us these words here. Now, the word of Almighty God. Paul writes, formerly, when you did not know God, you were enslaved to those that by nature are not gods. But now that you have come to know God, or rather to be known by God, how can you turn back again to the weak and worthless elementary principles of the world, whose slaves you want to be once more? You observe days and months and seasons and years. I'm afraid I may have labored over you in vain. Look at this language, Southwest, verse 12. He says, brothers, I entreat you, become as I am, for I also have become as you are. You did me no wrong. You know it was because of a bodily ailment that I preached the gospel to you at first, and though my condition was a trial to you, you did not scorn or despise me, but received me as an angel of God, as Christ Jesus. What then has become of your blessedness? For I testified to you that if possible, you would have gouged out your eyes and given them to me. Have I then become your enemy by telling you the truth? They, he's talking about the Judaizers here, they make much of you, but for no good purpose. They want to shut you out that you may make much of them. It is always good to be made much of for a good purpose, and not only when I am present with you, watch the language again, my little children, for whom I am again in the anguish of childbirth until Christ is formed in you. I wish I could be present with you now and change my tone, for I'm perplexed about you. Good morning, family. Galatians chapter 4, verses 8 through 20. I have read from the greatest book ever written, and I bear witness this day, all of its words are true. Amen? Amen. The war was over, but he just kept on fighting. The war was over, but he just kept on fighting. Hiroo Onoda was born on the 19th of March, 1922. He would grow up to become a soldier in the Imperial Japanese Army of World War II. History tells us concerning Hiroo that on the 26th of December, 1944, he would be deployed to a place called Lubang Island there in the Philippines, where he was given the assignment to come alongside other Japanese soldiers who were fighting the war there. Now, what you need to know about Hiroo is that he was given direct orders from his commanding officer, do not surrender under any given circumstances. He gets to Lubang Island, he gets to the Philippines, he begins to fight the war. But being in 1944, you know that just a few months later, the war would be over. And of course, the story is one of Japan trying to tell its soldiers in those outer-lying areas of the world, the war is over, lay down your weapons, come back home. And so they would send planes over where their soldiers were stationed, one which was Hiru and the rest of his fellow soldiers, to drop down the leaflets with this notice: the war's over. Lay down your weapons, come back home. But when they got the leaflets, Hiru refused to believe it. He labeled it as propaganda, and they kept on fighting. A few months later, they send planes again. They drop the leaflets. The war's over. Lay down your weapons. Come back home. They refused to believe it again. They called it propaganda, and they kept on fighting. Got so bad in 1952, the Japanese send another round of planes with leaflets full of handwritten letters with pictures of their family members begging them, the war is over. Lay down your weapons, come back home. They refused to believe even that. Labeled it as a cheap trick and kept on fighting. Year after year is now passing. Soldier after soldier is now dying. And now it's just Hiru Onoda all by himself fighting a war that had already been fought. The scene is one of him getting into skirmishes with the local police on this random island in the jungle. Every now and then he tiptoes into guerrilla warfare. He is surviving on subsistence living, eating banana skins and coconuts and stolen rice. He is fighting against all of the snakes and spiders and ants of the jungle. He is going through constant duress and constant exhaustion and constant anxiety, so much so that he did this for 30 years. 1974 rolls around, and for some way and somehow, the Japanese learn that Hiru is still alive. And so they do the work to find the original commanding officer to go fly to the island and give Hiru direct orders. Here's the picture right here. Soldier, the battle you are fighting has already been fought. Lay down your weapons and come back home. As we come to our passage, you would do well to understand that we have here another commanding officer in the person of the Apostle Paul. And he's now trying to preach a message to another set of soldiers. They are present-day Hebrews. They are the Galatian believers who, when it comes to salvation, are refusing to believe the message that Jesus Christ has saved you through his work on the cross. But they picked up the weapons of religious performance and are believing a false gospel that says that God loves me and God accepts me if I am a good person. So the commanding officer says to them again, what I say to you today, when it comes to salvation, by himself, Jesus really is enough for you. Lay down your weapons, believe on the gospel, and come back home. I want to talk to you about the futility of religious works and believing that your performance is what saves you. And in so doing, I want to walk through these three ideas, table of contents for our time together. I want to pay some homage to the fact that on some level, works do make sense. But then I want to remind you what the text does to say that our works don't work. They never have and they never will. Only Jesus' works work. And I want to give an homage, if you will, to verse 12 where Paul says, I entreat you. It's the Greek word deomai, which means I'm begging you, come home to Jesus. And with regards to that text, I'd like to tag this text, a pastor's plea. Let's pray. Jesus, thank you for these few moments. Breathe into us the breath of life. Holy Spirit, bring revival in this house. Bring renewal and salvation in this house. And there be some here today, God, that have never heard the good news that Jesus loves me all by myself, without me having to do anything other than put my faith in what he's done for me. Oh God, if it be their first time, make it clear and call them home. For we pray in Jesus' name. And every heart said, amen. Okay, can y'all give me just a few minutes before we have lunch? Okay, can I get a barbecue brisket nachos witness up in here? Okay, It's catfish out there. I ain't gonna preach long, I promise. I can smell the catfish, okay? Hey, I'm gonna get into the message, but you've got an assignment. There are 50-something Corvettes out there, and I need everybody in this church to lay hands on the Corvette and say, "For Ricky, Lord, in Jesus' name." And if you pray, God is able, amen? He's able, I believe him. Hey, let's go to the classroom for a few minutes. I promise we're in a church. Let's do some work here, okay? Let's do some excavation on the text to kind of start to mine the truths that are here for us. Because just a perusal of Galatians chapter 4, verses 8 through 20, you would walk away knowing that there are all sorts of directions that we could take this sermon, which would be entirely worth our time. It's a big passage. Some of y'all saw the words, right? Like, what's he talking about? Enslaved to those things that are not God's and weak and worthless elementary principles of the world. What even is that, right? All of these things that he's going that will be entirely worth our time. For instance, we could talk about how this text exposes what I like to term the lamentable spiritual condition of the Galatians. Everyone looking this way, because you got to do the hard work now to feel what they are feeling and to hurt the way in which they are hurting. And the emphasis of the text is this notion, watch this now, that the Galatians have fallen. The Galatians have stumbled. The Galatians have reneged on a hope that says my salvation is fixed squarely in Christ alone, and they're believing that my salvation is fixed in Christ plus my good works. And insofar that that doesn't work, you need to understand that they are exhausted and they are anxious. Because last time I checked, when you think your salvation depends on you, not only does it not work, you're going to be real tired thinking that it does. And so you need to feel what they are feeling. They have fallen. They have stumbled. They used to be, watch this now, spiritually strong, but now they are spiritually weak. You can't help but see this in the text. I mean, Paul is taking extra emphasis here upon just how strong they used to be. He's saying, you used to have it. There was this point where you were cooking with grease. There was this point where I knew that your love was squarely fixed on Jesus. Look at how you loved me. Look at how you received me. Look at how you cared for me. If I would have asked for it, you would have gouged out your eyes for me. Translation, you guys authentically understood the gospel, but now something done happened. Can I get a spiritual seesaw witness? And things sometimes go up and down. Things have changed, verse 9. He says, but now look at you. Your faith is on you. Your faith is not in Jesus. Your faith is on your resume. Your faith is not in Jesus. Your faith is what you can perform, not what Jesus has performed. And he rebukes them, verse 9, you have turned back to the weak and worthless principles of the world. We could have gone there. But also we could kind of see the heart of the passage. Oh, go home and read this word. Go home and get this passage in your spirit. Go home and get on your knees with your Bible and ask Jesus to touch your heart like he touched mine this week, because you can't help but see, watch this now, what I like to call the patient, persistent, passionate, pastoral posture of Paul. Say that five times fast. But you can't help but see the heartbeat of a real pastor who has now laid down his weapons of academia, and he's laid down his weapons of the intelligentsia, and he's laid down his didactic approach, and he has picked on the humility of a shepherd who is concerned about the spiritual plight of the sheep. And you see him, as it were, weeping behind the text when he says, verse 12, I am begging you to turn back to Jesus. Verse 19, he says, in an affectionate way, you are my little children, and I am in anguish in childbirth until Christ is fully formed in you. I am not Paul. I am not one of the upper echelons of preachers, but allow me to humbly tiptoe into Paul's footsteps. And I am here today, dear brother and sister, to beg you to turn to Jesus Christ. I am here unapologetically to say that there is only one salvation that will work for you. It is in Jesus Christ. Turn to him today. I'm begging you. I am begging you. Only Jesus can save your soul. So there's many places we could have gone, but if my granddaddy were here preaching this message, the old man would say, son, the main thing is to keep the main thing, the main thing. When we come to Galatians chapter 4, verse 8, the main thing is the thing that has been for the last several chapters is this: Jesus only. That's it. Only Jesus saves. Only Jesus can free you. Only Jesus can nurture you. Only Jesus can fulfill you. Only Jesus can restore you. Only Jesus can secure you. No one else, nothing else but Jesus. And I heard the songwriter saying, "What can wash away my sin?" And the angel screamed back, "Nothing but the blood of Jesus." I heard him cry out, "What can make me whole again?" Hear the good news of the gospel. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is that flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know. If you need salvation today, nothing but the blood of Jesus. He's going back to the same old thing. Only Jesus saves. Now, two-thirds of you are like, "Yeah, that's good. Keep going." One-third of you are Bible theologues. You're church nerds. You've been tracking along with us. You bought 5 Bible studies to help this series. Okay? You got Beth Moore bobbleheads at the house. You got David Jeremiah on CD and cassette. And you just heard for the 10th time in this series me say that this sermon is going to be Jesus only. You didn't do it in the natural, but I saw you in the spirit. You rolled your eyes in the spirit. I saw you. I saw you. I saw you. Okay? You rolled your eyes. Why? This again? Jesus only again? I mean, goodness, Ricky, the snow's sticking. Come on, move to something else. Well, here's the thing. We're a Bible church, and we don't get to move on something else until the Bible moves on something else. Come on, somebody say amen up in here. So this Sunday, the preaching is Jesus only. And guess what's coming next Sunday? Jesus only. Can I keep going and have some church here? Guess what's happening next month? Jesus only. Guess what we're preaching through next year? Jesus only. If the Lord tarries and I'm still an old man on my cane preaching on this stage, guess what we're going to preach then? Jesus only. We need to hear that every day. You know why? Because we forget every day. So Jesus sometimes has to be gracious enough to repeat things because we forget things. Think about this. John chapter 15, verses 1 through 11, the great abide chapter. Jesus says 10 times, I've counted. Okay, Greek word meno means remain. Jesus says 10 times, abide in me. Abide in me, abide in me. It's right before he gets crucified with the disciples. Abide in me, abide in me, abide in me. It's like a minor bird. Abide in me, abide in me, abide in me, abide. And I'm like, low key, Peter, James, John, how imbecilic can y'all be? I mean, are you boys deaf that Jesus has to say it 10 times? And the Spirit spoke to me and said, I said it 10 times because I know the human heart that forgets 10 times. And so I'm gracious to remind you in your life over and over again, only Jesus saves. My point is this, as we go to the meat of the text. Listen, friends, if Jesus says something 2 times, underline it. If Jesus says something 3 times, highlight it. If Jesus says something 4 times, circle it. If Jesus says something 10 times, you need to tear the page out your Bible and paste it to your forehead. It's Jesus saying, listen to this, because on Sunday you get it. But stuff happens on Tuesday and Wednesday and Thursday where you start to believe this lie that you got to be this perfect person. And here's the problem. Nobody's perfect, which is why the gospel says somebody perfect came for you. And your faith in him is what makes you saved. Okay, y'all already have some church. I'm going to preach. I'm supposed to be short because I need to get y'all out there. Whatever. Okay, you can go to another church where they preach for 10 minutes. Okay, but let's do something perhaps ideological here, okay? And what I want to talk about is this. Look, can we just agree that at least at surface value, works do make sense? Okay, now we've been setting that on fire for 10 weeks. Your works can't save you. Your works can't save you. But I think we need to give like a little affirmation to everybody. Can we just all agree that works do make sense, okay? Notice the Chris Farley air quotes outside of sense, okay? Works do at least make sense. It just makes sense that I ought to get something back for doing something right. That I ought to get some kind of reward for the effort that I put in. This idea then that God loves me and God accepts me and God will get me into heaven because I've been impressive, let's admit that at least make sense. There's a lot of you out here that believe that, yeah, God's going to get me to heaven because I was a good person. That at least makes sense. There's a lot of folks that believe this, but the problem is that that's a lie. And it's a disconnect because some of you believe that Jesus will save you by grace, but get you into heaven by works. Amen, somebody. Should I preach to the walls? Maybe they'll say amen, okay? We believe this. Some of us believe, yeah, he'll save me by grace, okay? But I get into heaven according to my works. Here's your problem. I've read the whole book several times. Hadn't read that yet. Not there, okay? A lot of us believe it. We believe as if salvation were this life raft that God gives us. Jesus, please let me get back up when I get up in here. A lot of us believe that, yeah, he loves us, so he came to die for our sins. So, yeah, I got a life raft. I got a ticket into heaven. We believe this. Yay, Jesus. But our heart believes a lie that now that we got a life raft, we've got to do these good things all the time in order to sustain the life raft. We don't believe that he's good enough and kind enough and loving enough all by himself. We believe he needs some help so we can do what we really hope that he will do, because we won't believe that he'll do what he said he'll do. Amen? God told me to tell you, throw away the oar. You're free. Help me get up, Jesus. This life raft that God has given you through his shed blood, it really does work. Hallelujah. It really is good enough for you. And why is that such good news? How many of y'all know that every day you don't feel like oaring? And everybody said, amen. And we've got something full and sure, the shed blood of Jesus Christ. But let's just agree, works do make sense. We believe and we're groomed in a world and in a culture that says we ought to be rewarded for our work. Do good, get a return. Majorities of workers who quit a job in 2021, the Great Resignation, they say that low pay, no opportunities for advancement, and feeling disrespected at work were reasons they quit. What is that saying? We believe we ought to get something for working hard. Of 2,000 Americans surveyed last year, doing good deeds makes 92% feel happy, 77% feel relaxed, and 72% feel healthy. What's the point? I just want to give you some acknowledgement that getting something for my work does make sense. We live in America. This is a meritocracy. We invented a nation that says if you get out there and pull up your bootstraps and work hard, you will get a return. And to some degree, that absolutely works in the world. Here's the problem. With the gospel, it's the complete opposite. Your works aren't good enough because your works aren't perfect. And God's requirement to get into heaven is perfection. And that's why the gospel is good news, because he said, since you can't be perfect, I'll send my son who is. He'll be perfect on your behalf. Put your trust and faith in him. You get in not because of your work, but because Jesus worked for you. And can we get real? This is deep. Can we just be honest? Because let's call it what it is. I like people better when they work hard versus when they lazy. Anybody who's gotten their order wrong at McDonald's was supposed to say, amen. Your order ain't never been wrong at Chick-fil-A. That's God's chicken, okay? But can we just be honest that I just like people who put in effort more than I like people who don't put in effort. We think that way. We breathe that way. Nobody wants to get heart surgery done by the cardiologist who got D's in med school. Can I get an amen right there? Nobody wants to drive their car across a bridge that was designed by the engineer who was self-taught. Nobody wants to do that. If I ever need brain surgery, I don't want the neurologist who barely graduated med school. I want a valedictorian. Can I get a Johns Hopkins witness up in here? We want the best. But the gospel says we couldn't be the best, and only the best gets in. So the best came for you, so that when you put your faith in what he's done for you, you are now part of the best. Amen. Ain't that good news? Works do make sense. But here's the point of the text. Works don't work. Works don't work. Paul's saying the gospel is not opposed to effort. The gospel is opposed to earning. And the whole idea of the gospel is that in the gospel, we do not work for acceptance. In the gospel, we work from acceptance. But the whole idea is that our works don't work. Look at one of my favorite expositors, Dr. Adrian Rogers said, some people think salvation roots in the merit of man. They think salvation is a reward for the righteous, but really it is a gift for the guilty. That's what it is. And that's what Paul's doing here. Verse 9, stay with me in the classroom for 4 more minutes. I promise I'm going to church, but verse 9 is so huge, so rich. He says, you've turned back to the weak and worthless elementary principles of the world. Verse 8, he says, you guys have become enslaved to those things that by nature are not gods. Translation, little g gods, not big G God. You put your hope in those things that cannot possibly save you. Verse 10, what's the rebuke? You guys observe days and weeks and months and festivals and years. What's he talking about? The Jewish calendar, the Mosaic system. You're putting your faith in what you do instead of your faith in what's been done. Here's the problem with that. Everyone looking this way. When you put your faith in what you do, then your salvation means that you're the hero of your story. And here's the problem. You ain't that good a hero. Because the requirement is perfection. So Paul is calling this out with this one line, works never saved anyone. As I close, there are some of you who today who've been in church forever, but you believe this. You believe, I gotta be a good person to get into heaven, but you're exhausted and you're anxious, but I've come to warn you, it ain't even working. And you need to believe on the gospel that you're saved by grace through faith in Christ alone. The word elementary principles, Greek word stoikei, S-T-O-I-K-I, that's how you spell it. Hard to translate, hard to interpret, but essentially it means the way the world does things. One scholar interpreted it, the ABCs of the world. You're going back to a cultural perspective of the gospel where, yes, God will love me if I do something for God. But the problem with this is that if you believe it's about your resume is just not good enough. And Paul, who had plausibly the best resume ever, is saying, my resume didn't work for me. Only the grace of God did. Okay, listen. If you think you got a good resume, if you think you're pleasing God and impressing God, your resume needs to move over because it can't touch the Apostle Paul. And mine sure enough can, okay? You think you're impressive? Let me tell you about Paul. We are confident that he was fluent in at least 6 to 7 languages. Fluent. He's a polyglot, okay? 6 to 7 languages. I always say 7 because 7 preaches better. Okay? 6 to 7 languages. Fluent. He was immersed in both rabbinical philosophy, which is a big deal, and Grecian philosophy, which is another big deal. Could tiptoe out of traditions and disciplines effortlessly. He was smart. He was to the law a Pharisee. You know what it meant to be a Pharisee in Paul's day? It meant you would have memorized the Old Testament word for word. The average Christian today has not even read the entire Old Testament. Paul memorized the Old Testament word for word. Some of us think that he memorized it in Hebrew and Greek. That's a lot of memorization. He was to the law zealous. He said that he literally fulfilled the entire Mosaic law, all 613 laws he followed meticulously. He was the best of the best, the strongest of the strong. Scholars say, were you to find someone commensurate with Paul's theological acumen, you would have to find in 2022 a scholar who has 7 earned PhDs. This guy saying, I was the best of them all. I had the greatest resume. But when I found Jesus on the Damascus Road, and I looked at what Jesus did by grace through what I did according to works, and my resume couldn't compare, hallelujah, with the grace of God that he put on the inside of my life. Grace is better. How better was it? Paul says, Philippians 3, I looked at my resume and said, I count it all as dung. It's a biblical word for poop. Paul says, your works ain't nothing compared to what Jesus has done for you. Now, Ricky, why does this preach? And Ricky, you got to hurry up because I can smell the catfish. I hear you. Why does this work? What's going to make those who haven't believed in this believe on it today? Because if you're believing that it's you plus, or it's Jesus plus you, okay? Can I just say something real gentle, but it's the real thing I wanna say? You're insane. Can we just say that? Like, it's insanity. I can't say, if I was preaching in Mississippi, I could say S-T-U-P-I-D, because it's okay in Mississippi. In Southern California, it's just not okay. So I'm not gonna do that, because I get emails when I say that. I'm not gonna do that no more, because I've learned I'm a Southern California by grace, through faith. So I'm not gonna say that. But I will say, it's insane. Why? Think about now Jesus' resume. Ready? Okay. Invented and created the cosmos. Okay? Trillions and trillions of stars that we know of, billions and billions of galaxies that we know of, an entire cavernous universe, the likes of which you and I will take an eternity to wrap our minds around. There's sun, moons, and stars. If the sun moves a couple of miles closer, we burn up. If it moves a half mile back, we all freeze to death. Okay? Oh, Ricky, don't get into evolution and don't get into science. Oh, Ricky, I'm a Big Bang Theory. I'm Big Bang too. My God is big. One day he said, bang! Mountains, stars, rivers, valleys, got a desert and said, one day I'm gonna put a church in a desert. I'm gonna put an aquifer under it so they can actually play golf all day, even though it never rains, because I'm God. And he did it all with a let there be light and never had one bead of sweat coming down his brow. Oh, want me to add to it? Red Sea, that was kind of impressive. Grand Canyon, Jericho's walls, raised Lazarus from the dead, went to earth, died himself, laid hands on himself and got back up. Here's my point. Do you think that you are better at saving you than this God? You're insane. So get off the rat race of performance. Get off the hamster wheel of works. Ricky, are you saying works don't matter now? God doesn't discourage us being moral. You're called to be. I just work from forgiveness, not for it. Rest in that life raft that he's offered for you. Because you're tired. And in my Dr. Phil voice, how's that working out? Rest in Jesus, amen? Movie Saving Private Ryan. It's about these soldiers, right? Led by Captain Miller, Tom Hanks. And the whole idea of the movie is for these soldiers to find this one soldier that needs saving, Private Ryan, right? And of course, the movie is about all the ups and downs they go through to find this special soldier, Private Ryan. Well, they find Private Ryan, and they're so excited, but it looks as if they're gonna have this big battle before they can take him home. And of course, the story ends with this epic battle that they have. Well, Captain Miller, the leader, gets mortally wounded in the battle, and he's up against the post. Y'all remember this? And he's breathing his last breath, and he's about to die. And Private Ryan comes up to the captain, and he's comforting him. And in this epic moment, right before he dies, his last words to Private Ryan were, "Earn this. Earn this." And you fast forward to the movie, Private Ryan's an old man now, and he's at Arlington. He's looking over Captain Miller's tomb, and you see the worry in his face. You see all the anxiety. You see the weight. Because he doesn't know if he's been good enough to earn what the captain had done for him. And in a moment of desperation, he calls his wife, and he's shaking. He says, "Tell me I was a good man. Tell me I've lived a good life." And she encourages him, but this is the rat race of performance. Yes. When you're trying to be good enough. Now, this is why Jesus' works do work. 2,000 years ago, there was a better Captain Miller. Yes, yes. Who also went through a battle to save his soldiers. And hanging on a cross called Calvary, this better captain didn't say earn it. With his last breath, he says, it is finished. This is the gospel of Jesus Christ. I got to be respectful of the text. And in verse 12, he says, I entreat you. In a closing prayer, everyone looking this way because I may never see you again. I beg you to trust him. I beg you to try him. I bear witness, Jesus is real. I bear witness, he died on a cross for you. I bear witness 2,000 years later that he rose again from the dead. And I bear witness this day, he is soon to come again. Will you be ready when Jesus comes? Being a Christian doesn't mean being a Jesus freak. Doesn't mean hollering like Rick. Don't even mean going to church. It just means I couldn't do it. And I heard he can. So I beg you, trust in him today. Every head bowed, every eye closed, as we close in prayer. If that's where you're at today, you believe this thing. You want to try it. Scripture says, prove me now herewith if I not open up windows of heaven to pour you out a blessing of which you will not have room to receive. Would you receive Jesus today? Whisper these words in faith. Jesus, I'm tired of running and I want to turn to you. I confess my sins, but I put my trust in faith that Jesus only is enough for me. I believe in your death. I believe in your burial. I believe in your resurrection. I believe you're coming back again. And so I put my faith in what you've done for me, not in what I do for you. I'm saved. I'm saved. I'm saved. If you prayed that prayer in sincerity, I welcome you to the kingdom. And I want to see you up at these prayer planted tables so we can pray together. In Jesus' name. Amen. Let's go home. Open up your hands like this so we can go home, okay? Y'all ready? Okay? Hey, barbecue, cheeseburgers, catfish, snow cones. Hallelujah. Hey, don't forget, pray over that Corvette. Ricky. Seriously. Till we meet again, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and to be gracious to you. The Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon each and every one of you and bring you peace. And I ask this blessing in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. God bless y'all, guys. See you outside.